Okay, maybe we talk about NumPy now. NumPy is the numerical package for Python, and it has several maybe interesting features. First of all, remember lists. So list is a native feature in Python. We can just define a list. In this way, we can say, okay, cornered brackets, and then we say 3.0 high true, and these of course are three different types, and we can print that now. Maybe I print that now. Okay, so we get here the printout of this particular list. In NumPy, we have arrays, and the idea is an array is something like a vector. In fact, we can do operations that we know from vectors, for example, the dot product. However, and they look a little bit like lists. In fact, we can convert lists into an array under some precondition, and that is that somehow the NumPy need to be able to convert all the items to the same underlying type. And the same underlying type that is possible for NumPy either is an integer or it is a floating point number. So for example, I can say here y 6 and 7. So now this is initially a list, and now we want to convert it to an array. So we can do that here, and then I can say here this should be the list. This Y list should be transformed into an NP array, and the type, the data type, should be an unsigned integer, unsigned short integer. So 16 is here the number of bits to represent these numbers. So I can show that, maybe print out then. Okay, and we see here this works fine. We have here an array with three items. Instead of using an unsigned integer, we can have also a signed integer. Just remove that thing here. And maybe here we say minus 3.0. Oh, why? Maybe I should save it for. And here we get a minus 3. Also, we can convert it to float. For example, to float 32. So now all the items here, you remember here, you see there's no dot. Here's the dot indicating this is a floating point number. And there we can also say 3.5 to make it more obvious. And you see, so we get here 3.5. Okay, what else can we do? We can have also dot products between two vectors. Can say t is my second vector. Initially it's a list. Okay, and I create an array out of this list. Again, here I need to replace this. And then I say I want to have the dot product of these two vectors. That can be done with np dot t. And I execute it now. And here we get then the dot product. So this would be this item multiplied with this item plus this item multiplied with that item, this item. Oh no, this item multiplied with that item, that with that, and that with that. And that should result in 12.0. We can also find out the shape of the vector. there's an NP shape function, NumPy shape, and there we can find out what is the shape of a array. Just to make the result more clear, I comment this out. The sharp sign is of course comment in Python, and then we see the shape is 3. So this means we have here 3 items. This is a 3-dimensional vector. We can also reshape. You can say np.reshape. Okay, and yeah, and then I print out the shape of every y again after that. You see here, before the shape was just a 3-dimensional vector, and now the shape is 3.1. And maybe we just print out now every y. And we see this is actually the printout for a matrix. Maybe to make the things even more clear, we create a 3x3 matrix. So we could say, matrix is equal to okay, so this, in a moment, this is just a list of 3 lists, and each of these lists contains 3 items. And now I can, with the same instruction, I can create a NumPy array out of that. So I can say here array matrix. Actually, this is then really something like a matrix. And I use then here this list of lists as an argument, and then I can maybe print out the shape of this array matrix. Maybe just I print out the matrix itself. And we see here this is the matrix. We can also make a dot product between a matrix and a vector. Here is the dot product. Maybe I leave out the reshape. Also, this wouldn't be a problem in this case. So maybe I remove the unnecessary parts now. Yeah, so I create here first a vector y, first a list y. I create an array out of that that is de facto a vector. I reshape that into the shape 3.1. It would be a 3x1 matrix. I create a list of lists. I redeclare that as a array, so it's a 3x3 array, and then I print out the dot product. Okay, and if I do that, I get then a dot product of this vector composed out of these numbers multiplied with the matrix here. Okay, we can then give the result the name result of this dot product. The result is then also an NP array. However, we can convert this result to be a list again. So we can do that here and print it. Okay, and then we see here, this is printed as a list of lists where each of these lists contain just one item, because before, so the result is of the shape 3.1. We can also reshape that. We can say np reshape. I think this should be corner brackets for a list. Okay, and then we have just a list of these items. We can also define a product of two matrices, of course. Let's do that. So we create an array. Maybe I just make here a list of 30 items. Remember, this range operator creates a list with items from 0 to 29. And then, yeah, data type. Is a 64-bit floating point in this case. Maybe then we reshape it. Here we can also use tuples, by the way. And maybe I create a second matrix. With 20 items. And also I can reshape that. Or we reshape it in a different way. We say here 15 times 2, and here we say 2 times 15. That should work. Let's try that now. Okay, at least no error. Now we want to have the dot product. For the dot product, it's only necessary that here the number coincides with that number, and that is the case. So we can calculate the dot product between R and Q. The result is, ah, no, I should not do that. I should have here 10. Strange that didn't result in an error. Anyway, so let's try that. We calculate the dot product. Also, okay, yeah, here we need to replace R with Q. That's why we didn't get an error before, but now we got one. And then we have the dot product. Yeah, let's call this M. And we want to have a look at the shape of M. And that should be, of course, 15 times 10. Yeah, the these 2 and 2, they are concatenated. No, I didn't save it. And here we get the resulting matrix with 15 times 10 elements. This is M. Let's say we want to see a subarea of these items of M. We can also do that. Maybe we want to have a sub-rectangle, the items from 2 to 5 and from 4 to 7. And we want to have these items printed out. So we can also do this with lists, by the way. So we say here is this colon, we want to have the items from 2 to 4. 5 is the first item and doesn't appear anymore. And here we want to see the items from 4 to 6. 7 doesn't belong to that anymore. And these would be the corresponding items. So this is a 3 times 3 matrix. We can also count the items from the end. So we could also say here minus 2, minus 5, minus 4, and but the numbers should be, or the order should be opposite. This would be the, let's say this is the last element, and this is the element before the last element. And here also we say the last element and 3 elements before the last element. And then we get this thing here with only a 1 times 4 matrix. The previous binder is just this shape one more time. I can comment it out, of course. Yeah, we get here the last row. You can also see the entire last row. That would be here. I can just leave the colon here, this means I want to have all the items in this row. And then we get here the entire last row. Okay, let's make a next step. We can also include another library in addition to Pyplot, in this case just for the visualization. And this is the this one, Pyplot, and this can show some curves. Here, for example, we show a vector. First, we create here a vector. Syntax of this vector creation is the following one. We can say, maybe something like I percent 3 for I in range 20. Maybe I cut and paste it to command line. So I do that now. It's like I start the Python and then I just cut and paste it in. And this creates me then a vector with 20 entries, and it's always 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, etc. And it's not a vector, it's a list. Yeah. So this is creating a list. And the entries are 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, and so on. And here, this is used to create a vector with 300 entries, and each of the entries is a value that belongs to a sine curve. And we can plot this, and then we show the result. So here I stop the Python again, and I start the demo. First, I need to save it, of course. Okay, and here we are. So this is the plot of a sine wave. So in the following, we want to use that. For example, we can calculate the Fourier transformation. And maybe, as you know, one way to do Fourier transformation is the fast Fourier transformation, is FFT. And NumPy has support for that. It's called FFT. What we should do then in this case is we should if we want to use FFT, then the array that we want to use it with should be an exponent of 2. Yeah, so maybe something like 256. And then we can calculate the Fourier transformation of this T array. By default, a Fourier transformation is on complex numbers. But we can use here an array with sine values. These are, of course, float 64, float 32. Then the result of the Fourier transformation is going to be a complex number. Let's try this first. Oh, so here. Okay, now we do that. Okay, we can do the Fourier transformation. And then we call this the f of t, maybe f underbar t. And we can also plot this. Maybe we plot the real part of it. Yeah, here the wavelength is is 20 pixels. So let's change it to 32 pixels. So then this is a part. So we have eight waves inside. We have eight waves in 256 values, and then we plot the Fourier transformation. So we should see a peak at 8. Let's try that out. Okay, this is the original value. I comment that out, and we use then this thing here. We have to show the plot too. Yeah, so this is still T. Maybe I say F of T, the Fourier transform of it. Okay, and here we go. Yeah, that is a little bit strange. I think we should make it a little bit more clean. Maybe I want to see first. Okay, I have solved some smaller problems here. We can take the Fourier transform, and then we plot the absolute value of the Fourier transform. And here I added also this PLT subplot command that makes it possible to have two graphs inside one plot. I show how it looks like if I run that. So the top graph is going to show the sine wave, and the bottom plot is going to show the Fourier transform of it, the absolute value of the Fourier transform, I should say. So this is the picture, this is the sine wave, and this is the Fourier transform. And you might be surprised that the Fourier transform gives a result for, well, about 1. And, this is not 1, this is something like, 8. And 256 minus 8. And that is because the FFT shifts the zero. The zero is here, but the negative numbers are here. So this is actually minus 8, and this is plus 8. If you want to have that correctly, we have to implement this shift. Map this shift. So one way to do that is we can initialize this as a array of zeros. From 0 to 256, and then we say G up to 128 should be equal to FT from 128, and below 128 should go to
this range here. And then we plot, instead of f of t, we plot g. Okay. Maybe I should say here d type is equal to complex, or we made it this way. Yeah, we say here zeros, and then we say here eps ft, and then here also eps ft, and then we can remove this here. Let's see how that looks like. Yeah, so here we see these peaks. The first peak is plus 8 and the other peak is minus 8. We can also shift that by changing the frequency here. So we could say we, instead of 16, we want to have 32. So this doubles the frequency here. The wavelengths, doubles the wavelengths. And we see here then the peaks move closer to zero. So yeah, the frequency becomes lower. Actually, we can have also constant here. We can say, well, t should be in p ones in the range from 0 to 256, and that makes, of course, t a constant value. And then we have a peak exactly at 0. Yeah, or we can use very high frequency, for example 128. Oh no, this is a very low frequency. Well, we can use the opposite, just a wavelength of 8 pixels. And then we see the peaks of the Fourier transformation far away. We have to imagine zero is here, yeah, in the middle between these two peaks. Okay, so far.